think where they live. And so he suggested that if we're going to look for our ultimate origins, then that would be the best place to our origins. And ultimately, that has come to pass. So there is a huge amount of shifting evidence now that has been gathered on people over the last few decades that suggests that Africa is where the earliest evidence for our own species evolved. And that takes us around 2.5 million years ago when we come to first evidence of the genus Homo. Our anatomically modern human ancestry dates back to probably around 250 to 300,000 years ago in Africa. And again, the fossil evidence is pretty consistent with, and the dates are pretty consistent with the idea that that's where we're ultimately from. And finally, the next major piece of evidence is genetic. And I know that the genetic diversity of modern day Africans is much higher than the genetic diversity of everybody outside Africa. And that supports the idea that people outside Africa are a smaller group of people leaving Africa in what we call the so-called founder effect.
It almost seems sort of, I mean, it makes sense the way you talk about it. It almost
seems counterintuitive, doesn't it,
that the rest of the world has a lot less diversity than one small, relatively small group.
Yeah. It's become much more complicated. We have found a small group of humans left Africa and started off from the African continent and left. Probably around 50 or perhaps 120,000 years ago, there's been a bit of debate about exactly which date. But we now know that there is a lot of complexity in Africa, and the idea that there was a single population that's ancestral to us is probably not true. In fact, what happened in Africa was probably that there were lots of different groups of humans living in different parts of Africa, and it's a lot more complex than we thought before. There were periods where they interacted with each other, and culturally, and ultimately, it was the case that a small group of people must have left, and we think that the main option that they would have had were to leave across the Sinai, the little peninsula that links Africa to Europe, or across the strait, a very southern point of the Saudi Arabian peninsula, the so-called Bab al-Mandab Strait. And so, through one of these two ways, we think that humans moved out of Africa into the rest of what we call the Old World, into Eurasia. The last few years have seen a tremendous increase in our understanding of when this happened. So we now have evidence just in the last few months that there must have been a much earlier exodus of humans, or early modern humans, up to about 270,000 years ago. We have evidence for that in Greece, from fossil remains or found in Greece. And later we have evidence for modern humans in Israel at two very important archaeological sites, like for those of early in the 20th century. About 120,000 years ago, but the main exodus, the main group of people moving out of Africa probably was much later than that, between 50 and 60,000 years ago. And that's when we find suddenly a great diaspora of people moving into places like Australia, Southeast Asia. We think Australia was probably settled around 60 to 65,000 years ago. And there are other modern human groups that by that stage also from places like Island Southeast Asia and Indonesia and so on. And there's possibly earlier modern humans that make it a final evidence there is a lot more controversial.
So you're saying some of this new work has only just come out in the last couple of months, though, so this is really still a very much under an evolving field.
Yes, absolutely. So the story of human evolution is really fast moving. And every few months something else happens that blows a hole in what we understood before, or adds a great deal more to what we understood before. So, for example, it's that we've discovered another group of humans that were living on the world. We call these archaic humans because they split off from our ancestors a very long time ago. So you can imagine them as, you know, Neanderthals. You can imagine them as sort of close cousins of Neanderthals. They're the beneath them. So outside of Africa, when our ancestors moved into Eurasia, they interacted and met with these groups of humans that had been living outside of Africa for much longer, and they considered Neanderthals in the west of Eurasia, the Neanderthals in the east of Eurasia, and probably other humans as well. So we have, for example, on the island of Flores in Indonesia, we have the hobbits living. So these are very small, about 1 meter high humans, Homo floresiensis. And earlier this year, another human species was discovered in the Philippines on the island of And so at one point in the world, there was probably around 5 or 6 different animal populations. They were all interbreeding with one another. And of course, many people will know that we have that genetic legacy today. So people like me, for example, who ultimately come from Europe, have around 2.5% Neanderthal DNA. And people living in Melanesia, Papua New Guinea, have the same amount of Neanderthal DNA, perhaps a little bit more, but also Denisovan DNA. And so we're finding in different parts of the world this genetic legacy, which is a result of our initial movement outside of Africa, and our interaction with human groups that were living in Eurasia, has led to the other way.
Humans had gone around and killed everyone, sort of everyone else that they met, as we did, and that was it.
But there was an excitement to find it. Yeah, this is the incredible thing. I mean, again, it's only in the last 10 years that this has been discovered genetically. Interestingly, there was tiny suggestions by physical anthropologists that some of the human remains that we find that date to, you know, around 20-50,000 years ago had some evidence, physical evidence. It looked as though there was a degree of partial mixing between Neanderthals and us. And this has been now demonstrated by the power of modern ancient genomics. I'll give you one really fascinating example. In 2006, I was involved in dating a human jawbone that was found in a cave site in Romania. And it had a strength, so it was about a hallmark feature of this monster. Identified some features of the jaw that looked archaic, that looked Neanderthal-like, and so he suggested that it may actually be some kind of hybrid. I must say I was really skeptical at the time. The DNA evidence was obtained a couple of years ago, which suggested that the physical anthropology was absolutely spot on. Not only was there evidence of Neanderthal DNA in the specimen, but it was present in such large chunks that must only mean there was a very recent ancestor, a Neanderthal ancestor in the life of a particular individual. And so we're able to say that that person had a Neanderthal great-great-grandfather. So a sort of 6 generations, a 4 to 5 months, or thereabouts, there was a Neanderthal ancestor. And so we're able to put actual generation times on the interaction between a frontier group, where before we just simply couldn't do that. So it's power-based DNA. They're really helping us to understand how it was that our group met one another 50,000 to 60,000 years ago.
And so, when we've got this interbreeding going on, did we pick up characteristics? Do we still have characteristics that we can point to and say, this is from Neanderthal, this is from these other groups?
Yeah, we do. And this is one of the most exciting things at the moment, is to figure out what we got from Neanderthal and Denisovans, and perhaps other groups that we are yet to discover. And what was positive and what was negative. So we already know that there were some positive things. So for example, we know that aspects of our skin quality and our collagen and our hair actually comes from Neanderthals. And Neanderthals are living in very cool conditions, so icy conditions for the most part in Europe for the previous 300 to 400,000 years. And so they had time to adapt and to cope with these kind of conditions. And it may be that when we integrated with them, those were some of the things that we then collectively used in our own genome. In the case of the Denisovan, there's some fascinating evidence that suggests that the formation of Denisovan was at the heart of the evolution of people living at high altitudes. If you look at, for example, people from Tibet, they have a gene that allows them to survive at altitude. It's called GPAS1, and it's a hypoxic gene. So it means that you can cope with very low levels of oxygen in your blood supply. Now you have children at higher altitude. And this gene was a complete mystery as to where it came from. Didn't evolve from humans, because people had fallen at altitude before they evolved this particular adaptation. But the other thing, that DNA, that gene, is found in the Denisovan. And it must have come from them, integrated into modern humans, and given us this amazing advantage. And early on this year, a human bone was found in a is where that adaptation occurred.
That was really fascinating. Now, one last thing. We were talking about diabetes, because I understand the diabetes gene comes from Neanderthal. And I said, so does that mean they don't have diabetes in Africa? Did you find the answer to that?
That is a really interesting question.
That's all right. I'm going to leave you with that as some homework, and you can come back to me.
I'm going to have to go and listen to that. There's always another question that arises. That's the great thing about Tom.
While we wait for Tom to get back to us about my diabetes question, which I'm quietly hoping won't alter the course of evolutionary science as we know it, I thought I'd bring our main query: where do I come from?
Now,